thank management of KPR and all the students, and I thank ma'am Valarmathi ma'am for giving this opportunity to deliver to the students of commerce, and it gives me immense pleasure to talk to the students through virtually. And when it comes to Python, this is a fundamental course, and don't take the course very lightly. It is not even fundamental. This is a predominant course in computer science. And when I decided to talk to the commerce student, I don't think that this topic is irrelevant. This topic is very much relevant to commerce department students also. So when I talk about the things on Python, you will understand why I'm saying this. What is the thing in it? What we have to do on Python, and how the commerce department has much rely on with Python. So these are the things we are going to discuss in this lecture. And I think this lecture would be somewhat productive, and you will go with some takeaways. I believe that you earn some credible information from this lecture. So this is Senthil Kumar N, Assistant Professor Senior Grade from VIT. And I believe this lecture will be somewhat productive and interesting for your learning, right? So with that, today's class, the agenda is, at first, before I go and talk about the details of Python, I will be giving you some basic knowledge on how to install Python on your machine. Second, the very important thing is, what is CPU and what is memory management? If only you understand what is CPU and how the memory has been allotted for your programs and other variables that you declare for the programs, then only you will write your program correctly. I always discuss with my students that writing program is not important. You have to think about how much memory we consume for writing the program and how effectively we are getting the result, right? How fast we are getting the result. That is very important. So if you are not aware of what is CPU and how the memory management works for your program, it is other ways to talk about programs. So I'll be giving a good length of content on memory management in this lecture, so that you have some comprehensive idea about how the memory has been allotted to your programs. After that, I will be discussing with Python, why Python to commerce student, what you have to do with the Python program, in what way you can augment your skills, and what is a simple Python program. After that, I will be spending some time on making you to understand variables. I think that you already studied C++ and other programming languages in the last semester, OOPS programs. Right? In that also you studied variables. But here we are going to deviate somewhere different, and we are going to illustrate some magics of creating variables in Python that we are going to discuss in this lecture as well. After that, we are going to discuss about what are the data types we have in Python when compared to other programming languages. In Python, we have certain programming constructs and programming data types. Advantages are there in Python. Yes, that we are going to discuss. And why we choose Python? Because of overwhelming built-in functions. So that we are going to discuss what are the functions we have to utilize for the program. And finally, the list goes a long way. Say in 2 hours, we cannot complete the entire Python. You cannot make yourself skillful in Python in 2 hours, right? So wherever possible and how far it is possible, yes, I try to give the content to you. So I stop the lecture by working on strings. So with strings, we stop the lecture because there are plenty of things to learn on Python. So I believe that by putting an end to strings is enough for this lecture. So after that, I take your questions, right? So, but first we start with Python. So where to get Python? To install Python, you have to go to your website, www.python.org. There you'll be getting downloads menu. You'll be getting a downloads menu. Now, recently, last week, they announced a new version of Python, that is 3.10. Now you have 3.85. Just before October, just 1 week before, we have the latest version 3.85. But now we have 3.10. The new version has emerged out. So you can download the latest version. So where to download in Python? So you can go to python.org and then you can install it, right? And there are many editors available for Python. Python IDLE is there, Spider comes under Anaconda distribution, PyCharm, Visual Studio, and Jupyter. there are many versions. Anaconda is there, right? There are many versions, many editors are there. Which one you to choose? That is a very important question. How can I try myself to master in Python? Where I have to install and how to install it? So these are all the questions you may have. So for that, I'm going to give a brief idea about where to get it and how to install it. So these are all the options. You can go for Python IDLE, or if you are convenient in Spider, yes, you can go for Spider, or you can go for PyCharm. PyCharm is not recommended because it is somewhat complex. For common students, it is not required. If you are a good programmer, you are doing multiple programs, you know many programming languages, say you know Java, you know C, you know C++, you know PHP, you know HTML. Suppose you are doing many things, then you better go for what Visual Studio Code, VS Code. It is a good editor. Suppose if you are dealing with more programs in different programming languages, in such cases, yes, I recommend you to go for VS Code. Because in VS Code, you can type any programs, whether it is HTML program or JavaScript program or Java program or PHP program or Python program, any program you can execute in VS Code. That's an important thing. But thing is that it takes so much of memory on your laptop. So that is a one disadvantage of Visual Code, VS Code. Otherwise, if you are a computer science student or if you are a common student, know many programming languages. I heard from Valarmati ma'am that you are studying already OOPS and in this semester you are studying DBMS. So you can go and try Visual Studio Code also. Otherwise, suppose you are doing simple Python code. I want to experiment simple things. I want to learn how Python works. For that, you can go for Jupyter Notebook also, right? So I just give you enough information about where to install and how to install it. You just go to python.org for Python installation. And there, click download. There, install, download Python. Latest version is 3.10. Earlier version is 3.85. You install it. So this is an old image. So you can check your computer, laptop, whether it's a 32-bit processor or 64-bit processor. If it's a 32-bit, you have to choose 32-bit. Otherwise, you have to go for what, 64. And then if you want to install Jupyter on your notebook, simply go to the website .https://ipython.org. So for Python IDLE, you have to go for python.org. Please remember, for Python IDLE version, for that you have to go for what, python.org. Suppose if you want to install Jupyter Notebook on your laptop or a desktop, for that you have to go for ipython.org, or you can go for what, jupyter.org. Once you install, then how to install in your local machine? For that you have to use pip command, P-I-P, Python installation. That's the meaning of it, right? Pip. If you're using Mac, I don't think nobody is using Mac over here. So I believe all are using Windows. Suppose if you are using Windows operating system, because I am using Windows operating system here. So better go for what, pip install hyphen upgrade PIP. Once it will be installed on your machine, then you have to go for what, pip install to hyphen upgrade IPython Jupyter. It will be installed. Once it has been installed, how to open the Jupyter notebook? For that, you have to type a command called what, in the notepad, in the command prompt, you just type Jupyter notebook, the window will be open where you can type your programs. Right? So PyCharm. Now in the PyCharm, suppose this is not for computer commerce later students, suppose someone is doing many big projects, for that, if you are a community, there are many groups in the project, for that you have to go for a PyCharm. So this I will not recommend for students, but if you want to use it, yes, later version is also available. So you can go for this one. Now see, for all of these, I have not given the demonstration. For all of this, I just given you the fact of where to get it and how to install it. But I have not given you any demonstration of how to install it on your computer. Why? Because there is a purpose. I just given a theoretical explanation of how to install Python on your laptop or on your device. But I have not given any demonstration of how to install it. Because if I given a demonstration of it, it will take almost 5 to 10 minutes, because it will take some time to load it. I have to install it. And I have to show you, because I already installed some of the Pythons and other things, Spider, in my laptop. So I cannot demonstrate it again. I have to delete it. So it will take time. Also, that is not a fact, because I have an inner agenda. What is that agenda? I don't recommend any of these softwares for you. Point number one. Why I have given this? Because you should know what all the options we have. You should know what all the editors we have for Python. You can go for Python IDLE, or you can go for Spider, or you can go for VS Code, or you can go for Jupyter Notebook. Anyone you can install on your laptop. But I don't recommend any of these on your laptop to use, because we have an excellent feature called Collab. Google Collab is there. No need to install anything. No need to install any software to be installed. No Python installation is required for your laptop. You can execute your Python program on the fly, wherever you want, wherever you go, wherever you want to execute. Yes, you can execute it without installation of Python. So Google Collab, all you need is you need an internet connectivity. Second, you have to have a Gmail account. That's all, Google account. If you have these two things, yes, you can execute your Python code without installing Python on your machine. Please understand it. This is very important, because now you are a student. Later, after graduation, you may be a programmer for any financial institution or any business corporations, for anybody. For that sake, you may go in and around from different places. You cannot carry your laptop all the time, right? So if you have an internet connectivity and if you have a Google account, then you can demonstrate your work, you can write your code, you can put your visualization on any kind clients, wherever you want to go and wherever you want to project. Yes, you can do that very easily. So Google Collab is an excellent future. It's a boon to, it's a gift to all the people, right? So I will demonstrate you how this is getting worked out. There is no demonstration required. You can use it. You can very easily use it. So this is what I have to recommend. So please use Google Collab. If you think that you have internet connectivity, yes, you can use it, right? That's a very important thing. It runs on a Google server. It's a cloud environment. It's directly connected to your cloud and no need to install anything. No need to install anything. And all you need is you need a Google account. That's all, an internet connectivity. So I just give you a demonstration, right, of this. Just a minute.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
So sorry for the interruption, sir. Kindly enable slideshow, sir.
Yeah, no, ma'am. I'm want to demonstrate. Now you're seeing the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I just want to demonstrate to the students how this is getting worked out.
Okay, sir. Okay, you can get
Google account. Are you seeing my Google account?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yeah, now see, this is Google, right? I already logged in over here. Now see, this is my login. So I already logged in as sendilkumar.new@gmail.com. This is my login. You just go to Drive, Google Drive. You just click the buttons over here. You just go to Google Drive. You just go to Google Drive. And now here, my drive is here. Are you following me? Just click my drive. When I click my drive, I have more option here than in that Google Collaboratory. Google Collaboratory is there. So just click that. Once I click here, Python is open. That's it. All you need to do is you have to add a Google account. That's all. My Python program is working. A equal to 10. I'm just saying yes equal to welcome. I'm just printing it. That's it. So it is connected. It is connected now. Now you can write your code over here. This is a code. Yes, you can type your code, but it depends upon your internet connectivity. It depends upon your internet connectivity. So please use Google Collab. What is the advantage of using Google Collab? Because, ma'am, can you see the slide now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, because I want to switch here and there, so that you can have some good understanding of this is how this is been happening. Now see why I have to use Google Collab. First point, the very first point is you can save your code and wherever you want to use it, yes, you can use it on different laptops. So you have a program, no need to copy the program to different machines. You just log into their Google and you can open the program anywhere. That's one thing. Second one is, suppose, see, we are all using CPUs. Our laptops, our desktops are all CPU based, right? CPU means what? It has certain limited capacity, the RAM capacity and gigahertz capacity, processing speed capacity that I'm going to explain later in the slides. So it has limited capacity. But if you're dealing with big data, suppose imagine that we are dealing with images and graphics and movies, videos. So that time, CPU is not sufficient to handle the videos and the images. So for that, we have to go for graphical processing unit, GPU. So if I go for GPU, I have to add a newer laptop. I have to go and purchase a new version and high-end laptop. So it costs more than 1 lakh and 2 lakhs. So I cannot afford for it. So that is as a point number one. Point number two. Point number three is, say, if I deal with some real-time data like traffic data, satellite images, and any financial data, stock market details, these data are very, very huge. And it is enormous. Also, it is growing exponentially on every day. Stock market exchange, on every day, we see different points and different scales and different rates. So it's growing. People in the stock market is very huge. Every day it is growing. And people are doing so much of business and trading on stock and other things. Likewise, if we come to traffic, we have to scale each and every activity of the road. How many people goes in? How many people comes in? What's the sensor? What is these data are very, very huge. These are real-time data. Now, do you think that my laptop is enough to accommodate all the data into it? No. Your data, your laptop or desktop computer may be of 1 terabyte. But my data size is what? More than megabyte and petabytes. So if it is more than terabyte and petabyte, how can I accommodate all the data into my laptop? It is not possible. If it is possible, how can I process it? CPU and GPU is not sufficient to handle all the data to process. And I want to get the result immediately. So for that, we have to go for what? TPUs, Tensor Processing Unit. So if you install Python using Spider or Anaconda or VS Code, your laptop must be of high-end version. That is not possible. Your laptop is of CPU based and it has a limited capacity. So you cannot handle if you have more number of data and if you have more data sets. So that's a major problem. We choose to go for what? Yeah, Google Colab. So just log into Google, go to Google Drive, just choose more option. In the more option, you can find Google Collaboratory, click it, then you can execute it. Now you have an option. Suppose if you want to execute only the CPU, yes, you can go for that. Suppose if you want to use TPU, yes, you can go for that. You have to go for notebook settings and there you can change it. You can increase the speed of your execution. So this is a kind of advantage we have on Python Collaborator. You can use your code anywhere. So today you write the program and save it on local disk means what? Your memory is wasted. Your laptop memory is wasted because you are typing many programs and it didn't save on local drive. So the memory is getting wasted unnecessarily. So, but if you use Google, you are saving your data to the Google Cloud so that the Google Cloud is utilizing the memory of it. And whenever you want to access the code, yes, it paves way for you to get the data for you. So this is an excellent future. That is why I'm saying, please use Google Colab. That's the only option. That's the easiest option. That is an affordable way for writing Python programs, right? So with this, I stop the explanation of installing Python. If you want to install Python, yes, you can go for python.org. There you can install it and you can work on it. You can using IDLE or using Spider, yes, you can work on it. But if you have internet connectivity, if you have an option, I recommend the students to go for Google Colab so that you can save your code. You can share your code to your friends also. If anybody wants to know your code, yes, you can share it. You can give the link to them so that they can see the code. They can know about your code, how that is working and what you have done for the code, what novelty you brings into the code, that you can know, that you can share to your friends. So that is why I'm recommending Google Colab to use. So I believe that this is a useful information. And next, for next 5 minutes, I will be giving you some basics of computers. You may think why this faculty is explaining the simple things about computers, why it is required now, because these are all very, very important. You will understand how this has been useful for this lecture. So please listen over here carefully and focus your attention over here about how the central processing unit, memory management, and then fetch cycle is working. You all know that CPU is the brain of a computer because all the operations can be carried out in CPU. Whenever I give an input, CPU can process it and it gives the output to you. If I say C equal to A plus B, if I give value for A and B, then it calculates C equal to A plus B and value of C will be printed as a result to you. Who does that for you? The CPU is doing it. So CPU is a main component of your computer. Without CPU, we cannot do anything. CPU is very fundamental and it's a base of any computer system. So CPU is a brain. And how do you measure the speed of your CPU? Earlier, it was in megahertz. just 2010 and before, it was in megahertz. But now we have different version. Here we use Intel iCore 5, 4, 3 like that. Now we have i7 and 8 and it's coming, right? So if you're using iCore i7 or i8, it is of what? 3.6 gigahertz. Suppose if it is 1 megahertz, that means 1 million cycle per second. That means what? It can fetch the instruction, execute it, and give the result. So how many instructions it can fetch? 1 million instructions it can fetch. We see about the performance of the gigahertz, megahertz, CPU capacity. How much of instruction you can take out? Per second. I'm talking about per second. In per second, you can execute 1 million cycles, iterations, execution speed. If it is gigahertz, see 1 billion cycles. That is why when you listen any songs in your laptop, we are not seeing any gaps. We are listening a song continuously. We are doing the task without any hindrance. We just follow the execution because we are not seeing any differences when I go for execution in CPU. Do you know anything about how the CPU is executed? Which task is it is executing and which task is not executing? No. But understand, yes, CPU, if I have CPU and I have more than one processor in a CPU. But if I think that if I have one processor, uniprocessor, imagine a case, I have only one CPU and one processor. That means, yeah, processor can take only one task at a time. Please understand that. One processor means what? Suppose I'm opening a Winamp player, MP3 player. Means what? I'm opening only one application, one app. Now that app is going to CPU for execution. If it is going for CPU for execution, that time what happened? I am not seeing any break in hearing the song. I keep on hearing the song. But CPU is going to execute only one task at a time. Suppose I'm giving other tasks, like I'm opening a Jupyter notebook, or I'm opening a browser, or I'm opening any stock market applications. So I'm giving multiple applications to the CPU that also be executed parallelly one after other. But you are not feeling any difference, right? Otherwise, what happened? You can't listen a song continuously. You'll see some break, you see some pass. So that is the guarantee the CPU is giving. So that is why we are using what CPU? Intel iCore 7, that means what? 3.6 gigahertz. Right? So the speed of your execution, your program executed very fastly means that is, it is the speed of the CPU. So what is very important is the CPU capacity is very, very important. If you want to write a good program and if you want to get the result of the program very fast and efficiently, in such cases, the complete control relies on CPU. That is a very important part. So that is why I given it. Next one is RAM. You all know about it. RAM, random access memory. What is the use of RAM? RAM has two capacity. One is it stores your data temporarily in the main memory. It stores your data temporarily in the main memory. So if you have large data, the RAM capacity cannot handle. You cannot accommodate large code into RAM. That's a problem we have. That is why I recommend you to go for Google Colab. Don't install any Python. Just use Google Colab. If you have internet connectivity, if you have a Google account, yes, you can go for Google Colab. Suppose if you have a problem at home, you have no Google, at home you have no internet connectivity, then you have to install Python, right? So here, if I have a RAM, the RAM is two purpose. RAM is having two purpose. One is to store your data. Second one, to increase the speed of the execution. Even though I have CPU, if you want to execute faster, it depends upon the RAM capacity. That is why when you go for buying a mobile phone, you are buying the mobile phone with more RAM, 2GB RAM or 3GB RAM or 4GB RAM. Because why you choose like that? When you go for purchasing a mobile phone, whether it's an Android phone or a Mac or iOS, whatever it may be, if you're going for purchasing a mobile phone, first thing you see is the RAM capacity. Why you're seeing the RAM capacity? Because higher the RAM, then the faster the execution. And the mobile can do all the tasks simultaneously without any problem. That is a major things. Likewise, for CPU also, we need to have a RAM. For increase the speed of the CPU, what is important is the RAM capacity is very, very important. And all your data for execution is stored in RAM only. So all the execution can take place through RAM. So the data can be stored only in the RAM. Please understand, it's a main memory. You store your data permanently in the secondary memory or disk. But whenever you want to execute the CPU, for that you have to copy the code from secondary drive to RAM so that the CPU can execute the code. Where the code will be now? The code is there in the RAM, that is the main memory, and CPU takes the code from the main memory and executes it. So that I can take the task very fastly. That is the meaning of it, right? So higher the RAM, the speed of the execution also very high. Yeah, that is the meaning of RAM. So this is the second point I want to emphasize. Then this is a fetch execution cycle. I have to tell you about it because there is always explained in CPU. What is the central processing unit? It executes the fetch execute cycle again and again. Suppose we have 10 lines of code and I have 5 instructions. First, it fetches the instruction, execute the instruction, and repeat again. So what happened? The speed of the cycle is defined by the speed of the processor. Suppose I have 10 lines of code in the Python and I have 5 commands are there, keywords are there, execution commands are there. So I have to go and execute it. I have to take it, execute it, take it and execute it. So what happened? If I have a 1 gigahertz, it means 1 billion cycle per second. In a second, I can execute all the programs. Not a second, in nanosecond, in millisecond, I can finish up the program because the CPU capacity is what? 1 billion cycles per second. So I'm giving only 5 lines of code. 5 lines of code is nothing. It can do without any time. No time I can finish a task. So the speed of the CPU is determined by the gigahertz. That's why you can go to your computer, right click it, and just go to general. There you can see the computer speed in what gigahertz it is going. So you can check it in your laptop also. If you have a laptop at home or computer at home, you can check it there. Right? This is a very important aspect. Next one, what is a program? Program means we as a student, we as a programmer, we as a client, writing programs for achieving certain things. If you want to perform certain activity, if you want to perform certain tasks, for that we have to write the program. So that program is always a consists of set of instructions. The program is always a set of instructions, means what? Commands. That commands will be taken into CPU for execution. And CPU process the execution and give the result to the user. That is an output. So programs are written in high level language. So what are the programs you know? You know C program, C++, Java, Python. Many programs are available. So you need to know about many programming languages. So which programming language you are comfortable at, that program you can take it out and you can go for execution. So that is a program. Second one is, please understand that you know program, you know C++, you know OOPS, you know Python, but machine don't know that. All the things the machine know is, it know about zeros and ones. It know only zero and ones, that's all it know. When I say anything, the machine is going to understand it as what zeros and ones, that is called binary code. And you know what? Yeah, IN code, that is called what? You know that IN version of the programming language, you know the higher level language. So you write the code in English, but system can't understand the English language. It can understand only that the machine language. What is the machine language? Machine language is zeros and ones. So this is the language I'm giving. Suppose I'm saying x equal to x plus 4. This is shortened operator. If I say x equal to x plus 4, means what happened? Add is a command. Why? Because I'm using plus operator over here. So automatically, there is a mnemonic code. Assembly language code is being generated. Add S1 means what? X. S1. So these are things is going to be executed and 4 is going to be added with S1 plus S. So for this equivalently, a binary code will be generated, right? So this I am going to explain very clearly. So now I will take some time for you to make you to understand about how the machine language is being generated, right? How the machine language is, this is how the machine language is going to generate it. The machine is going to understand only zeros and ones. It is not going to understand any other thing. If I type A or if I type cat, if I type any word or any numbers, all it understands is in number form, in binary form only it is going to understand. That I'm going to give you some insight so that you have some good understanding of how this has been happening in the computer, right? So always, how the data is going to be stored? The data is going to be stored as 8 bits, that is 1 byte. For each and every byte, there is an address. There is an address. I think you all know about what is formatting. You formatting your disk, right? You're formatting your laptop also. You're formatting your mobile phone also. Suppose if there is any virus comes into your mobile phone, you just go to a mobile shop. There you ask for formatting your mobile. That means that what? It remove all the content and it clears the values in the content, the memory, and then it segment the memory. The segmentation of memory is very, very important. It is of 8-bit segmentation. That is 1 byte. Based on byte only, it is getting segmented, tracks and sectors, right? That we'll discuss later. But how this has been working out? For each and every character, letter you are seeing in the keyboard, A, B, F, 1, 2, 3, 4, what all the letters, all the things as an ASCII code. Now see, the letter A has ASCII code of 64. And letter small a is having a code of 96 or 97. Right? This is 97, A, small character A. And letter dollar, ash symbol having a character 3. Right? And the parenthesis, asterisk has a special symbol, ASCII code 10. So when I type asterisk, the ASCII code is what? 10. When I say A, capital A, the ASCII code is what? 65. When I type a letter Z, capital Z, the ASCII code is what? 90. Right? For each and every character that you type in keyboard, it has an ASCII code. Right? So for that, what I'm going to do is, I just going to give you a demonstration of how I'm going to work this. Say this is a bit. Are you seeing this? Are you seeing this now? This Word document? Please.
Yes.
Hello? Are you seeing it, sir? The voice is breaking and you're a judge, it is didn't seem. Suppose say.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Now I'm clear. Now say, if I want to type a letter A, what I said, the machine is going to understand only zeros and ones. Please understand it. The machine is going to understand only zeros and ones. Now, when I type a character A, capital A, it has an ASCII character 65. Imagine. It has an ASCII character because it is given that capital A has ASCII character 65. 64 plus 1, 65 is the meaning of it. Now see, if I want to put 65, all the things are zero. This is a bit. Right? This is a bit. Now I remove these things. Wait a minute. I just remove all these things. Delta. This is a one bit. One byte equal to what? 8 bits. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 8 bits are there. So 1 byte equal to what? 1 byte equal to 1 bit. Sorry, 8 bit. It's called 8 bit. Now see, let's assume that all are 0. All are 0. This is a bit for space. This is ASCII value for space. There is nothing, it is for space, right? Now see, if I want to type A, a character A, what is the ASCII value for A? What is the ASCII value for A? The ASCII value for A is, say, I'm saying 65. Sorry, 65 is a value. So for that here, I have to make 1. And here I have to make 1. 64 plus 1 is what? 65. So what is the ASCII code for A? The ASCII code of A is what? This is the ASCII code of A. Sorry, it is copied over. 01000001 is the ASCII code. So the machine understand that. The machine is going to understand that. Whose role is that? The compiler role, the interpreter role, right? Whenever I type a character A, the ASCII character is 01000001. This is the ASCII code, I think 01. So this is the ASCII character. Suppose I'm saying B, capital B. What is ASCII code for capital B? 64, 66 is the answer. So I have to make it what? 1 year, 0. So 66. So this is the ASCII code for what? 01000010. This is the ASCII code for what? B. When I say cat, C-A-T, C-A-T, then what is ASCII code for it? Already I know this one. What is C? C? 67. So I have to make it 1. So I know what? C means what? 01000011 space. Then cat is what? A. 01000001. This is a T, means what? Some letter. So that is calculated. So when I say cat, it is going to be converted into binaries like this. It is going to be converted into binaries. Even for numbers, if I type number 1, 2, 3, 4, for that, what happened? It is going to convert everything into what? Yeah, binary sequence. So for all of this, how many bytes is required? 1 byte is required. So 128, 64. So every character can be given using what? This 1 byte. Within this 1 byte, you can do all the things. You can enter all the characters given in the keyboard. What are the characters I'm seeing? A to Z, small a to Z. Then I have caps lock. Then number 1, 2, 3, ash symbol, dollar symbol, hash symbol, percentage symbol, ampersand symbol, asterisk, parenthesis, equal symbol. All the symbol as what? What are I seeing in the keyboard except the functional keys? except the functional keys, except the functional keys, all the letters in the keyboard has a value, ASCII value. For that ASCII value, what we do is we do what? The conversion. How the conversion has been happening? Through compilers and interpreters. So when I type a high level programming language like this, what happens is when I go for compilation, it converts the source code into an object code. Who do that? The compiler. So what is a compiler? Compiler is an intermediate between the user and the machine. So you talk in English and the machine can go to understand only in zeros and ones. You type in alphabetical characters and machine is going to understand in binary characters, that is zeros and ones. So somebody, suppose when you go to a city, you talk in English and that person don't know English. So we need to have a translator. That person know only Hindi and you know only English. Suppose if you want to have a conversation, then there must be a person who know English and Hindi both. So if only a person knows Hindi and English both, that person only is eligible to translate your content to the person otherwise. Right? So that is an important task. So who doing that? Compiler here is like that. The compiler know the high level language as well as a machine language. When I type a program in English, A equal to B, print A like that. When I type everything in English, that can be passed on to a compiler. The compiler compile the code and convert into object code. What is object code? It is a conversion of high level language into a low level language. It's a machine language, zeros and ones. So the compiler do that for you. So when you have a program like C, C++, Java, so not Java, Fortran like this, .NET, these are all using compilers, Visual Basic, these are using compilers, right? What they do is they take the entire program, for the entire program all at once they convert into an object code. But if you have an interpreter, interpreters are programs that take the instructions individually, separately, one by one. First line first, convert it into binary code. Second line second, then convert it into binary code. Third line, convert to binary code. Fourth line, convert to binary code. It go one by one. But whereas compiler take the entire code. I have 10 lines of code, 100 lines of code. All the underlines can be converted into binary code all at once. But when I come to interpreter, even though I have 100 lines of code, I can take the code one by one. One line at a time, convert it, and then go to the second line, and then convert it, and it go like this. So don't think that it is getting slow. Since Python, Ruby, Swift, PHP, R are using Python, this interpreter, don't think that it is getting slow. Parallelly, it has been executed. That's the meaning of it. Parallelly, there is an operation going again. Whenever the conversion has been happened, automatically it is doing the execution. So line one is converted. Parallelly, what happened? Line two will be converted. When line one is executed, CPU, second line is getting a converted. So parallel is executing. There is no time delay over here. So don't think that when I go for line by line, it will take some time. No, not like that. Parallel is being executed in the CPU as well as conversion has been happening in the program by the interpreters. So these are two things you have to know on compiler and interpreter. So what I talked about so far? So far, I talked about what is a computer, what is CPU, what is the capacity of CPU, how we measure the speed of the CPU, and what is RAM, what's the role of RAM, what we can do with the RAM, and what is a fetch execution cycle, how much time it is taking to fetch the instruction, and it is based on the computer processor. As I said already, it is a computer processor. After that, we talked about ASCII value, how the conversion has been happening, how the conversion has been happening from one to other, that is high-level language to low-level language, and how it has been taking place. After that, we talked about what? This compiler and interpreter. Now we come to the main picture. The main picture is what is Python? So this was developed initially by Guido van Rossum in the city Netherlands, the state Netherlands, in the year 1980s itself. But it was getting popular after 1991 because earlier C and C++ were getting popular, and the majority of C and C++ code has been used in many of the applications and many of the defense forces. So at that time, Python was not used, and many of the compilers and interpreters of Python has been written using C and C++. That is why the popularity of Python has been getting delayed, right? And even now, Python is the most easiest code you ever know of. Python is very simple, but more powerful. It has many excellent features you can never come across in any programming language. Once you know Python, you love Python after that. Once you understand how the Python has been working, after that, you will not go begin any other programming languages. You start working under Python. It is very easy, and its interaction system is amazing. And the syntax is very much precise. It's very concise. So this preciseness is not there in other programming languages. Say, and I go to C program, you have to use curly braces, parenthesis, something like that. But here in Python, you don't bother about the syntax of it. Automatically, the machine can take the syntax of it. The alignment can be done by the machine itself. So I'll be explaining that also. Where the design is very much compact. And where the Python is mostly used, that's the important thing. Python is used for a general purpose programming languages as well as some special purpose programming languages. Even for Google search engine, Google uses Python, right? So we the country using Google, but China is using what? A different search engine. They are not using Google products. They are not using Gmail, Google, something like that. China is not following it. They have their own autonomy. They are their own software engineers to develop the code, right? They have a different search engine. The search engine is what? Baidu, B-A-I-D-U, Baidu. When you go to Russia, Russia have used different search engine. They use Yandex, Y-A-N-D-E-X, Yandex. So only the countries like India, Singapore, Dubai, some countries, Britain, these countries, Australia, New Zealand, these countries are using Google products. US has marketed their product to many countries, but they have not intruded into China and Russia. China will never allow US to come into their place. Russia will never allow US to come into their place. They develop their own search engine. How they develop their own search engine? By using Python. Please understand it. Google is also using Python. So is China is also using Python. Russia is also using Python for the search engine Yandex. Likewise, some of the mission critical projects that has been happening in NASA has been designed using Python. When we launch a satellite to moon or anywhere, we use codes to track the satellite. How much distance it has traveled? What is the technical details happening in the rocket? Is there any trouble in the rocket? What is the signal? Whether the signal is lost? What about the fuel efficiency, the fuel capacity, whether it is getting low or high or medium or sufficient? If you want to track the satellite details, or if you want to collect any satellite images from the space, for all of that, the code that we write for the program is Python. Please understand it. Likewise, as a commerce student, you all know about exchanging, financial transaction at New York, that is a stock exchange, right? For all of that, Python is used. So don't think that Python is for only for computer science students. Don't think like that. Python is very much applicable to you guys. So you have to take this challenge very seriously and learn it. The biggest beauty is Python is very simple to learn, very easy to follow. It is not very tricky, it is not very cumbersome, or it is not complex. It is very simple, very easy, but most powerful. You can use Python for your balance sheet calculations, for budget estimations. If you are going to study all these subjects in your curriculum, right? I believe so. So for that, Python is very important and fundamental for you. You can develop your own code. After third year, you must be in a position to write a Python code for your projects. Yes, you can do that. If you need any help, you can call me, I can mail me, I can talk to you about it in person, right? So you can do that. Thing is that you have to develop a skill on Python, very important. That is why I'm taking some time in making you to understand what is memory, how the values are converted into binary, when I give A, how it is being converted, and how it is getting stored. Because year after, we are going to discuss many things. I'm not going to give you a simple explanation of what is a program, how the program is going to be executed, not like that. Here, my agenda is very simple. I'm going to give you some efficient process of working on Python. I'm going to take simple tasks. I'm going to explain only simple things, but make you to understand in a different way. That is my ultimate aim, right? So with that only, I'm taking these primary things, the fundamental things for you. And now we are going to next step. What is that? Python is an object-oriented programming. Now, if I take C and C++, they are different. C is object-oriented programming, but C is not. You have not studied C, I think so. I heard from your ma'am that C has not been in your curriculum, but you have studied C++. Oops. Python is also a oops language. Please understand it. That is why it is powerful. Whenever we have an object, whenever we have object-oriented programming, that means there are more reliability in it, more robustness, and there is more scalability in it. That is why Python is an object-oriented programming. We have more powerfulness in this. So we can reuse your software. That is an advantage. When I have an object, the object can be reusable. That is the meaning of it. That's why we use Python. And now the interpreter, I already informed about it. Now I just go for demonstration here. Python, simple programs. So print hello world. It will be print hello world. So I just go over here. Now see, print the single quotes or double quotes. Welcome to Python. Program. See, if you are not seeing my screen, please let me know. I'm giving demonstration here. Sir, if you are not seeing anything, please tell me. Exhibit in the
tutorial.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Now see, when I say print, welcome to Python program, it will be display a message to you. Welcome to Python program. Right? Now you want to write a different code. Now click code, a different menu will come. Now see, if I want to say 5 × 10, what is the answer? 50. So when I'm saying it, what happened? It will be executed. 50 is the answer. Right? Suppose if you want to add any other things. Now see, any expression you want to type. 2 + 10 × 7/3. Now when I'm going to execute it, yes, you can see it. So what all the calculation you want to go, yes, you can go by that. All the things you can go over here. So this is the advantage. This is where you can write the programs, right? So the program is, you can click the code, it will come and write the program over here. Here I'm giving only one line of code. Later you're going to see many programs of it, many lines of code of it, right? Now see, this is what I'm given over here. Any complex expression, yes, you can give it. Next one is, we are going to talk about variable. Here, I am going to give you more insight of Python. Unlike other programming languages, why Python is special? What is there in Python? Why all the people are using Python? And all the companies have started using Python. Even when I go for NASA, there they are using Python. When I go for stock exchange or financial institutions or any health data or climatic conditional data, wherever we go, people started using Python. Why is that? What is the advantage of using Python? What is the convenience we are using for Python? That I'm going to explain on a simple fact and variable. Let's see. This is a very important thing. When you studied about variable in C++ or in C language or Java, people would have said different things about variables in Python, that in C++. But now I'm going to give a different thing. So how to assign it? Variable name equal to value. So X is a variable name. What is a value? 17.2 is a value. Y is a variable, -13 is a value. Z is a variable, X 17.2 into Y -39 in -2. So that is a value of X. So what is the variables? X, Y, Z are variable. What are the values? 17.2, these are the values. What are the values you know? You know integer value, float value, string value, Boolean value. Boolean value means what? 0 and 1. Float means what? Decimal value. String means what? Any alphabet, any characters. That is called strings. So that you know. Now, what is the speciality of variables in Python? That is what we are going towards. That is what we are inching towards. Now I am saying int x equal to 17. This is a C code I have. In the C, what we do is we have to declare the variable first. In C, C++, Java, C#, .NET, in all the proprietary software, when I'm using standard editions, the popular softwares like C, C++, Java, C#, .NET, in all the programming languages, there it is very important to declare the variables. If it is a variable of integer, then I have to say int x equal to 17. Then after that, I have to say x equal to 50. You can go like that. But here, integer means what? It requires 2 bytes. Float means what? It requires 4 bytes. You know about the bytes, right? 1 byte equal to 8 bits, that I already explained it. So when I want to store an integer, for that I require 2 bytes. For float, I have to go for what? 4 bytes. For string, for character, I have to go for what? 1 byte. So if I have 5 characters means what? Then 5 bytes is required. Allo, H-E-L-L-O. So 5 characters. So 5 characters means what? 5 bytes is required for allo character, allo string. Like that, it has been happening in other programming languages. Whereas in Python, we are not bothering about the data types. That is the first convenience. That is the first advantage of using Python. You got the point what I'm saying? You got the point? Say, I just go over here. In other programming languages, what we need to do is, right? What we need to do is, I have to say int a equal to 10. In C, C++, like that, I have to say like this. Now what happened? Why I'm saying this? 10 is a value I'm going to get. If you know that value of a is 10, then you have to declare a as integer. That is very important. But whereas in Python, you simply say a equal to 10. Now, what is happening here? That is the important thing you have to note down over here. What is happening here? Say, if it is C language, a C++, I'm giving int a equal to 10. If I say like this, what is happening? You just go to the memory. It just go to the main memory or secondary memory most probably. It goes to secondary memory, that is hard disk. Find 2 bytes of memory location, continuous space, 2 bytes of memory location. Then If it is 2 bytes of memory space free in the memory in the hard disk, then it allocates 10 value to the memory. Got the point what I'm saying? Before I store a value 10 into A, what the system is doing is it first find the memory for A. How many memory is required? How many bytes is required? 2 bytes, because integer means what? 2 bytes. Float means 4 bytes. Character means what? 1 byte. So here I'm going to give a value 10 for A. If you know that A is a value, A is a variable, going to get 10. In that case, what happened? It has to be initialized with the integer and then allocate 2 bytes in the memory. After allocating 2 bytes in the memory, the value of 10 is going to be pushed into the memory. Clear? If suppose there is no memory space for 2 bytes, then we can allocate 10. But in Python, it is not like that. If I say A equal to 10, what is 10 here? What is 10 here? 10 is not a value. Please understand it. 10 is not a value. The very first thing you have to understand is, that is a difference. That is a distinction here. The very first thing you have to understand over here is, 10 is not a value. Right? 10 is a reference. What is a reference? It is an object. 10 is an object. Now, what is A? A is a variable. What A is doing? A is referring the value 10. That is an object 10. Object means what? A value. What's a value? Integer value. What is integer? An object. What is float? Object. What is string? Object. Everything is an object in Python. Please understand. That is why I have said Python is an object-oriented programming. That is why I said Python is what? What is Python? Python is an object-oriented programming. Why? Because it is seeing everything as what? Yeah, object. Integer is an object. Float is an object. This one, string is an object. Boolean is an object. When I say 10, what is 10? 10 is an integer. So it is an integer object. 10 is an integer object. You got the point what I'm saying? But when I say the same thing in C, C++, Java, 10 is a value and A is an integer variable. It understand like that. Now see, I'm typing. Type of A. When I say that int A, no need to give semicolon. It is what? Type is what? Integer. Suppose when I say 10.5, A equal to 10.5. Now what happened? Now see what it is. It is a float. Right? Now if I say single quotes, I'm giving single quotes. If I put anything in single quotes, it is become a string. So it is become what? A string, str. The same thing. What I'm doing here? It is an object. What type of object? It is an integer object. It is a string object. It is a float object. Like that it is coming. Right? Now, the beauty of, this is not a beauty of Python. We are not still started the beauty of Python. I'm just going one by one, step by step. Right? So I'm print x equal to 3, print x. Then x equal to abc, print x. X equal to 3.14, print x. So it is printing all the things. Right? Now see, I want to find one important thing. What is that? A equal to 10 and B equal to 10. I say A equal to 10 and B equal to 10. What is happening here? When I say A equal to 10 and B equal to 10, what is happening here? This is an important thing you have to note down on Python. Please understand. This is a very important property. You have to know on Python. Very important feature. There is an important difference over here. When this is in other programming languages like C, C++, Java, Python, .NET, or C Sharp, when I say int A equal to 10, then here I'm giving what? Int B equal to 10. What happened? What happened here? Int A. What is A? A is a variable. Because it's an integer, I have to get what? 2 bytes. So it's go to the memory, allocate 2 bytes for A. Next, B. What is B? B is a new variable. For that, I have to allocate 2 bytes. So 2 plus 2, 4 bytes I'm allocating. 4 bytes I am allocating over here. You got the point what I'm saying? But here in Python, it is not like that. It is not like that. It is allocating how many bytes? How many bytes is required for it? Both A and B are integer variable. Both are integer object. So when I go for allocating a memory, what happened? Let's see. ID of A. What is ID of A? See the memory? This is the memory location allocated for A object. This is a reference ID. This is a reference ID allocated for the variable A. So A is a memory created, memory object created, object for 10 is created. Now 10 is created. What is 10? 10 is an object. What type of object? Integer object. It is created. Now, what is the address of it? 94002176826144 is an object reference. 10 reference now. A has been referenced to the same memory address. When I say next B equal to 10, now find the ID of B. What is the answer? The answer is going to be same. See there. Both A and B is referenced the same memory location, same object, same ID, right? So what is the meaning of it? So the memory is largely saved. The memory is largely saved if I use Python. The same thing when I go for C, C++, Java, there, what happened? I have to have 2 bytes for A and 2 bytes for B. Suppose I have 10 variables, all are integer variables. Then what happened? 10 into 2, 20 bytes I'm wasting unnecessarily. Even a single byte of memory waste is very important. You cannot think that, you should not think that memory wastage. If you use program, CPU, how much time it is taking to get the result, that is very important. How much time it is taking to get the result? It is not that I'm getting the output or not. You may get the output, that is different, but how much time it is taking? If I have multiple, say, the problem is, say, an example, I'll give a simple example for you to understand. Why I'm explaining so much on this aspect? Because there is a purpose. Say, if it's an integer variable, A, integer B, C, C++ code. What happened? A is stored in the location 200. Assume the memory hard disk, the address is 200. And B is stored in the memory location 500. Now what happened? When I say C equal to A plus B, I have to get the value of A. Then what happened? It go to A, find the value of A. It go to B, 500 address, get the value of B. And then add it and push the value to C. This is what happening. But in the same case, if it is C, that is Python, what happened? The memory location is same. The control is goes only once to get the value of A as well as B because the address is same. So speed will be very much high in this case of Python. You got the point? Now see, if I have 11, now when I see B equal to 11, what is the idea of B now? Is it same or different? Sure, it is of different. Why? Because B value is 11 and A value is 10. So A, 10 is a different object and B, 11, 11 is an integer object. So the address is different for it. The memory address is different for it. 76, this is 144. You got the point? So it is not only for, now see, 256. What is the value of address of the same and different? ID is what? Same, 16016. And now see, 016. So any two number you give, it is not only that. If I give what? Cat, C-A-T. And here, cat. Now see, what is address? 592. What is address here? 592. It is not only for integers. Please understand, it is not only for integers. Even for going for this one, cat and cat, mat, whatever the words, hello, whatever the word you can give. If both are referring to string object, that is a string object, cat is a string object, right? Now come back again. Now I come back again. I want to confuse you now. 256, right? Now I want to confuse you. Now see, when I go for here, what is ID? 016. What is ID? 016. Right? 016. Both are same address. Now here I'm giving for B, I'm giving 257. Now for B, I am giving 257. Will the address be same? Will the address be same? No. Why it is giving a different address? If it is a live session, we will be very interactive. We'll be asking questions. We can interact. We can learn a lot from this. But since it is in a virtual class, I can't get your answer. Now see, for 256, it is giving 016. For 257, it is giving a different memory address. Why? 257, sorry, sir. Here also it is 257. Both are 257. Both are 257 and 257 here. For this 257, it is giving 2064. And for this 257, it is giving 456. Up to 256, it is taking what? The same 0 to 256, it is taking the same memory address. If both the variables are having the same value up to 256, it is of what? Same. If it is more than 256, then it is different. So 257, or if I go for 258 or above 256, if you give any value, the object reference will be different, even though it is same. Why it is so? Because the integer memory range is, the memory range is 0 to 256 only. That is why I demonstrated here. This is what it is, 8 bit. This is 1 bit. Sorry, 1 byte. This is 1 byte. 128, then what happened? After that, we can have what? This is what? 256. Then we have 256. So you cannot go beyond 256. The memory range for integer or anything is 1 byte is what? Up to you can go for 256. If you have value above 256, it is exceeding the bit range, 1 byte range. So for that sake only, it is not recommended. For that sake only, you can take up to 256. 256, 256, no problem. 256 and 256, same value. 016, 016. But if it is 257 and 257 or 258 or whatever it may be, if it is going beyond of it, then what happened? It is giving a different value. So please understand that. Now see, mostly when you write a program in Python, we use values from 0 to 256 most widely. Predominantly and pervasively, we are using these values in the programs. So that is why Python has given this kind of convenience in the code, and the interpreter has been doing that kind of operation. Please understand it. That is why I'm giving it. Now see, I just go explain certain things. Now this is a slide. X equal to 17, Y equal to X plus 3. What is X value? 17. Z equal to W. This is error. Why? Because I have not mentioned the value for W. What is the value for W? I have not given anything over here. So X equal to 17, what I'm giving? 17 is an integer object created. X plus 3, 17 integer object plus 3, 20 is a value added over here. Z equal to W means what is W? I don't know what is W. It is undefined. That is the meaning of it, right? So these are all the things we have to know on variable. Then how to declare a variable? That is an important process. That is also an important process in any programming language. When you come to any programming language, how to declare a variable? Always it is recommended to declare a variable with a letter, alphabet or underscore. Suppose if you are using any machine related codes, for that it is recommended to go for underscore. Or you have to use alphabets only. The first letter of a variable must be an integer, alphabet, right? And it is always recommended to use a meaningful verb, right? So score, capital S, uppercase S. There is a lowercase letter, uppercase letter. Both are different. It's not same, right? So be careful when you're using a variable name. And when I go for a program, naming of variable is very important, because if someone look at your code, they have to understand what the code is all about, what program you are doing in it. By looking at the variable name, they can understand that this variable is going to get this value. So you have to give a meaningful name for the variables, right? And this is what I've given over here. So these are all the things I explained so far. So say when I say A equal to 10 and B equal to 10, both are referring to the same object. Suppose when I say A equal to 20, then what happened? It changed the address to 20 over here automatically. At first, both A and B are using the same object, reusability. That is a line I used when I talk about object-oriented programming. Object-oriented programming is mostly used for reusability. So the same object is going to be used for A and B. And when I say A equal to 20, that time a new object is created. So the value for ID for A is changed to 20 now. Right? Suppose I have variables x2, xn. All our values 10, 10, 10. Then what happened? All the variables are referring to the same object, only one object, 10 only. So thereby, I'm reducing the memory space. Thereby, the speed of the operation is very much increased. So if you want to do this sort of operation, this is very important. Sharing of memory and variables and memory reference is very important in programming. Next one. This letter Hyderabad is given. So when I go for this, yes, you can do this kind of activities also. This I explained already with cat and mat. So this we explained the same over here. So when I go for here, x equal to 10, y equal to 10. Is the operator. It's going to check whether x is y. Both are same. X is y or y is x. Both are same. If it is same, it is going to say true. If it is same, it is going to say A A equal to 10, B equal to 10. Now I'm saying A is B. If I say this, what happened? It is going to say true. Why? A value and B value are same. Both are different, the same object. So it is true. Suppose A value is 10 and B value is 11. Then what happened? What happened? When I do this, it is false. Because A value is 10 and B value is 11. That means both A and B are not same. Because object is different. Memory reference is different. So it is saying false. Right? So when I say both are same, A equal to 10 and B equal to 10, it is going to be true. Suppose if I say this, A equal to 10, comma 20, comma 30. This is one value of A. Now this is, again, I'm giving the same thing. A, comma, A, B equal to 10, comma 20, comma 30. If I say this, A is B. Now I'm saying, if I say A equal to 10, B equal to 10, A is B, true. Now I'm saying A equal to 10, comma 20, comma 30, and B equal to 10, comma 20, comma 30. Is it different? Is it same? The answer is going to be true? No. Why? It is going to be false. Even though the value of A is 10, comma 20, comma 30, and B equal to 10, comma 20, comma 30, both the values are same. Here the answer is what? False. Why? Because this is a list. It is not a variable. A is not a variable. Instead, it is a list. What is the difference of variable and list? Value means what? It is a constant value. 10 means what? 10. That's it. After that, I cannot do anything on 10. But if it's a list, 10, 20, 30, after that, I can give 35. It is possible. I can change a value. It is mutable. That is called what? Mutable. Mutable means what? Changeable. So list is changeable. Strings are changeable. Right? So when I give a value like this, what happened? It is going to give what? A wrong answer. So what happened? Even though the values are same, it is going to be false. It is going to be false. So this is called what? A variable and list. So please understand, the variable value only is going to be object creation. For list, it is not going to be created an object. Instead, it is going to create a different references. Right? So that is what is being explained over here. Y equal to 1 to 3, y x equal to 1 to 3, then x is y, answer is false. But if it is in a variable x equal to 10 and y equal to 10, x is y, the answer is what? True. This is what I explained. So when I go for 256, what happened? Up to 256, the value is what? True. But when I go for 257 and 257 or 258 or 300, any other value, the answer is going to be false. Why? Because the value is up to 0 to 256. That is an integer value. That is a byte value. If I go beyond the byte conversion, that time there is a problem. So for that sake only, the Python is taking only these values for object creation. That's all, right? So I think now you have some comprehension on how to deal with variables. What is the advantage we have on variables? Now come to data types. What are the data types we have in Python? As said already, that is the numbers. Numbers means what? Integer, float, strings. Then strings are separate object. List, tuple, dictionary, sets, and Boolean. So these are all the things you need to know on Python data types. So in this lecture, we are going to talk only about what? Numbers and strings. Because it is not possible to explain each and everything into the single class. So it is impossible. That is why I'm taking only what? Strings. So in this lecture, we are going to talk about strings. Before I go and talk about strings, we need to know about the three important data types: integer, float, and strings. These three are immutable. You cannot change the value of it. 4 means 4, that's all. 7 means 7. Float 13.2 means that is 13.2. It is a constant one. It is not changeable. But list are not changeable. That is why we are calling it as a mutable and immutable. An object is mutable if it is changing its value, like sets, list. These are all mutable. But an object is immutable if we cannot change the value of it, like numbers, strings. These are all fixed, constant. You cannot change the value of it. Data conversion, this is a data conversion. Say, when I say float of 17, it says 17. String of 17, I can convert that into a string, right? So you can convert from one thing to other thing. Like say here, I just go for a code. What I given? Say, float of here, sorry. Just maximize it. Float of 10. So 10 is an integer value. When I convert it, into 4.10.0. If I say string of 10, then what happened? It is going to convert it into what? str. Sorry, not a string, str. What happened? It is going to convert to a 10 as a string. So value 10 and string of 10 is not same. 10 is an integer. This is a string. So different object. So please don't get confused on this point as well. Right? So different object over here. So like this, you can do the conversion. And next one is, if you want to get a value from a keyboard, yes, you can get a value from the keyboard. Dynamically, if you want to assign, suppose here I given A equal to 10, something like that. Here I given value A equal to 10. So instead of that, you want to get the value dynamically, like scanf in C, C in C++, C in C out for printing, and C in for getting the value. So like that, if you want to get it, for that, what you have to do? A equal to, what is the symbol? Input, enter a number. So when I type it, what happened? It will be asking a value, enter a number. So when I say 10, enter the value, enter a number, 10 is the value is assigned. So when I go for print of A, what happened? It is going to print the value 10. So the answer 10 is going to be printed. So if you want to get a value like this, then what happened? You have to get it by input statement. Please understand that when I execute it, what is this? What is this? This is a text box. This is a text box. Whenever I enter any value in the text box, 10, 10 is not a integer here. 10 is not an integer. Say, let's go for it. Now, type of A. 10. Type of A is what? STR. Why? Because I'm entering it in a string text box. So you have to convert that into what? A string appropriately. You have to convert that into a string appropriately. That is what you have to do over here. Right? So this is a program. You have to take it. And some of the built-in functions, this is the next step we are talking going now. Some of the built-in functions of Python is OS, sys, math, random, date and time. Suppose if you want to know some of the details of your operating system, for that you have to import a package called what? OS package into your Python code. Suppose if you want to use any of the mathematical expressions like sin x, con x, tag, log of, seal, floor, or square root, or cube of it. So what are the spy operation? If you want to do any of the mathematical relation operation, for that you have to install what? You have to import what? Math. So I just go for a demonstration over here so that you can understand it. Suppose when I go for here, import OS. Now what I'm going to do is OS.name. If I say that, if you install Python, Spider on your machine, or you install Anaconda in your machine, then what happens? If you give this command, it will tell you what is the OS you install on your laptop. Your laptop OS is what, Windows 10 or Windows 7, whatever it may be. So that will save over here. Now, when I say import OS, OS.name, it will tell me what is the OS I am using. My laptop operating system is what, Windows 10. But when I execute it, now tell me what is the operating system name it is going to say? It is saying POSIX. Means what? Portable Operating System Interface. That is the meaning of POSIX. What is the meaning of it? If you type the same command in your laptop, it will tell you the correct operating system name, Windows 10, Windows 7, Windows XP, like that it will tell you. But here, what I'm doing, where I'm executing this code, I am executing this code in a Google. Please understand, I'm using Google Colab. I have not installed Python in my machine. Instead, I am using a Google server and Google is using a different operating system. POSIX means what? A portable operating system that is compatible on any server. This is an operating system. POSIX is an operating system which is compatible in any server, any environment, any platform. So this is compatible. So that is why it is showing like this, right? Suppose like this, if you want to use any mathematical functions, suppose if you want to use the same thing, suppose if you want to get OS, get command window. What is the command? Which command window I'm using it? Get command, CWD. It is a content. But if you're typing the same thing in your laptop, if you're using installed Spider or Anaconda, it will tell you the correct path, C:\Python/ in your program. This path will give you the correct path of it. But since I am using a cloud, a Google server, it is giving the content of where I'm typing it. This is a content code, code content. So it is giving code content. Right? Likewise, if you want to use any mathematical functions, so for that you have to use what? Import math. Import math. Math dot square root of 4. So it will tell you what is the square root of 4. It will tell you what is the square, the exact value. So square root of 4 is what? 2. So you can do like this. What are the functions you want to do? Yes, you can do that. right? So this is how you can use all of these functions. So math function, say here, import random, it will generate a random number. Math of square root, math of pi, it will tell you the correct pi name. So all the things, suppose if you want to use floor and ceiling, yes, you can do that. Say for an example, I just go for here, math, floor of say 10.2. What is the answer? This answer will be 10. Even if I'm going to be 9, it is going to be what 9, because it's going to float to the base value. Suppose if I'm giving seal over here, instead of that seal, the answer is going to be what? 11. The answer is going to be 11. So what happened? Come to do what? The nearest value, highest value. That is a floor and seal. That is a difference of floor. Like that, you can go for log operation, square root, sign of value, degree of something. So what all the mathematical function you want to use it in your code? Yes, you can use it using the math library. You can use it in the math library. Next one is, these are some of the mathematical libraries I'm using. Next, we move on to strings. Before we go and talk about strings, I want to talk something on the program of Python. Now we take some time in explaining some of the codes. Now listen carefully over here. I'm going to demonstrate how to write a Python program and what are the ways in which we can write the program. Now say A equal to 10, B equal to 20. Now I'm going to find which one is biggest, which one is largest. Whether A is the largest or B is largest. So which one is largest here? B is largest. So when I say A greater than B, answer is what? True or false? The answer is going to be false. Why? Because A is 10 and B is 20. So how can I make it? How can I give you a correct content? How can I make a correct content? So I'm writing. Here I'm writing. If A greater than B, you have to use colon. You have to use colon. Whenever I'm using colon, automatically what happens is the next line will be indented automatically. Alignment will be done automatically. See here, first two spaces has been given automatically to it. That means this if block is going to be executed over here. So print A is greater. I'm typing like this. Next one, now if I say like this, am I able there? Sir, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, audible.
Yeah, suddenly power cut because I'm using Wi-Fi network. Wi-Fi is cut off. It will take another 5 minutes to start. Now I'm using my mobile connectivity. Now see. Now if I say A greater than B, print A is greater. Now see, when I execute it, it is not showing any result. When I execute it, it is not showing any result. Why? Because A equal to 10, B equal to 20. If A greater than B, print A is greater. Print A is greater. So what happened here? A value is less. A value is lesser value, so it is not showing anything. So what do I have to go? I have to go one step back, else, colon. Now I have to say print B is greater. Is greater. Now, what is the answer? B is greater is the answer. I'm getting the answer like this. Now, shall we write a program like this in Python? No. No need to write any code like this, any logics like this. Whatever the operation you want to carry forward, for all of that, we have a function. That's it, simple. No need to use any logics like this, if A greater than B, else if this. No need to use anything like that. Simply you can go for what? Simply you can say print maximum value is, simply say max of, sorry. No, you cannot go like this, sorry. If it's a list, you can go for it, right? Let's go for list. Yeah, sorry, this is not a way to go. For list, I'm giving a list over here. Let's say 1, 5, 7, 6, 20, 15, 27, 23. So these are the values I have given. Now, how can I find which one is maximum? If you have two values, I'm going to use A greater than B or something like that. Now, for this, how can I find the maximum? For this, if I have given some set of values, how can I find the maximum value in it? For that, what is the logic we have to go? First, we have to assume max equal to 0. I'm saying this is the maximum value. First, you have to say max equal to 0. Now I'm writing for loop. We have to go for iteration. We have to take each and every value one by one. I will take one first. Compare. 1 is greater than max or 5 is greater than max. I have to compare each and every time. So what I'll do? For that, I have to go for loop. For I in A, what is A? A is having this much of value. What is I? I is iteration. That means what? It's going to a loop one by one. It is going to take first value of A. What is the first value of A? 1. Second time, 5. 8. So for loop, this for loop is going to take each and every value one by one. For I in A, what happened? What happened? If I greater than max, if I greater than max, what I'm doing? Max equal to I. So print maximum value is, what is the maximum value? Here I'm saying max. Now see, when I executed, it is going to say maximum value is 27. So I explain this code again for other people who don't know. I have taken some value. A is having how many values? 1, 5, 8, 6, 20, 15, 27, 23. So how many values I have given? 8 values I have given to a variable, a list variable A. Now I'm going to find which one is maximum. So for that, I don't know which one is maximum. So at first I initially say max equal to 0. At first, initially I say max equal to 0. Now maximal is what? 0. For I in A, first it takes one value. What is I value now? 1. 1 greater than max. What is max value? 0. 1 is greater than 0? Yes. What is maximum now? 1 is maximum. Yes. Second one. 5. 5 greater than max? Yes. What is value of max now? 1. So 5 is maximum. So 5 is a maximum now. 8. 8 is greater than 5? Yes. 8 is a maximum. 6 is greater than 8? No. 20 is greater than 8? Yes. 20 is a maximum. 15 is greater than 20? No. 20 is a maximum. 27 is a maximum. Yes, 27 is greater than 20 is the maximum. Next, 23. 23 is greater than 27. No. So 27 is a maximum. That's all. So this is how I have to write the program. This is how I have to write the program. Next one is, I am going to give a simple thing. This is not there in other programming language. For that, you have to struggle. You may think that why this faculty, this person is talking like this. This we already know. Suppose you already studied C++ and all the things. You may wonder why I'm talking this. Finding a biggest number is the biggest deal here. It's a simple thing. But why I'm explaining here? Because I want to say the beauty of Python. For everything, Python is going one step ahead. That is why I'm explaining all these things. Now the same program, I'm not going to change anything, but I'm not going to get the correct result. Finding the minimum. The min equal to 0. If I less than minimum, min equal to I, the same logic I am using. Minimum means what? Lesser than this, and minimum value is what? Minimum is 0. I understood as minimum is 0. Now what happened? 1 first is what? 1. 1 is lesser than 0. No. 5 is lesser than 0? No. Sorry. 5 is lesser than 0? No. 8 is lesser than 0? No. So what is the answer? I'm getting it. 0 is the answer. But is there any 0 in the answer? In the list? No. What is lesser? 1 is the lessest value, smallest number. Which one is the smallest number over here? 1 is the smallest number. But what is the output I'm getting over here? 0. Because I have said max, minimum value is 0. Minimum value is 0. So this is a problem you may face in codes. When you write a code, these are all the problems you may come across. So for that, Python has an excellent future. For this, suppose if you don't want, here the problem is, I have assigned minimum as a 0. At first I assume that 0 is minimum. With that assumption, I'm comparing all the elements in the A, the list. With that assumption, I'm comparing all the elements. So what happened? Ultimately, I failed because 0 is not even there in what? A. Suppose if I have zero over here, then answer would be correct. Answer would be zero because zero is minimum over here. I understand it. But since zero is not minimum here, I cannot get the answer. So how can I find it? How can I find it? Don't assign zero. Then how can I assign any value? For that in Python, we have an excellent keyword called none. I am not assigning any value to minimum and I start iterating it with a new value. So when I am not assigning anything to min, it is not doing anything over there. So now when the same code, when I do it, if min is none, that is if min value is none, if min value is none, what is the min value? None. Yes, it is correct. If min value is none and I value is less than m, first time when I executing it, min is none. Condition is true. So what happened? I am assigning I to what min. So that is the meaning of it. Min value is what? One. What is the minimum value for the given element? One is the minimum value. So I achieve the task very easily over here. So this is an important keyword. We have in Python, PHP, Perl, or in all the open source languages, yes, we have this keyword none. So this keyword is very fundamental, but it does our biggest job, right? So please understand how I'm writing this code and how I'm working on these codes. So these are all the fundamental things you have to learn on coding. Coding is all about how effectively you're handling it. Effectiveness comes in terms of memory and CPU execution. How much of memory you are consuming for your code, as well as how much time it is taking to execute the code. That is an important phenomena. These are two important phenomena we have to look at over again, right? So this is an important example I have given you for consideration. Next one is, we come to strings. X in S. X not in X. S1 plus S2. These are all some of the operations we have on strings. These are all some of the operations we have on strings. Now see, I have a string. S equal to welcome to Python program. Python programming. Now I'm saying I'm going to find a value X. Whether X is there in S. Yes. X. In yes, true or false? True. Why? Python is a word present in yes. If I say this, then what happened? It is going to say false because there is no Pythons in where? In yes. Only Python is there. So yes, in yes means what? This one. Suppose if I say not in, it is going to be true because there is no Pythons in Python programming. Yes, it is going to be true. Yes, that is what I'm explaining over here. X in yes, X not in yes. Given two strings, how do I concatenate it? Yes plus X. If I say this, what happened? Welcome to Python programs and Pythons. This is how it is going to be working. Concatenate means what? Joining two strings. Yes and yes can be added together. Right? So it is going to be concatenated. When I use strings, you have to use the word concatenation. When I use numbers, you have to use the word addition. So when I go for integer, float, for all of that, I do addition. Plus means what? Addition. But same plus for string is become concatenation. So that is what happening over here. So let's S into N. So when I go for S into N, S into N. So what is N? I have to define N equal to 5. So that means what? The same value, welcome to Python program, is going to print it how many times? 5 times. Welcome to Python program. So n times it is going to be printed. So n means what? Value of 5. So s into 5 means what? It is going to be multiplied the same value 5 times. Welcome to Python program. It is not multiplication. It is a different thing. It is a repetition of the same character. It is a meaning of here. Repetition. Right? So s of 5. Suppose if you want to extract one character from it. S of I. What is the letter? So if I say S of 1, what is 1 over here? It is not W, it is E. Why? Because the first letter index is what? 0. This is 0, 1, it starts with 0. The list or the array or the string starts with 0. That is when I say S of 1 is what? 2. That is E, right? When I say S of 10, what is the character? Space. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So this is 10. So this is space. So I'm getting space. Suppose if I'm giving 11, it is going to print what? P, because this is 11th character, Python. So like this, you can work it out, right? Length of it, all the things you can go, right? And concatenation, find the length of it, length of the string. So if I go for length of S, what is the length of S? Suppose you want to find how many characters are there, the given string, for that you can for length of S. So if I say length of S, 29 characters are there, the given string, yes. So like this, you can go for length minimum. What is the minimum character? So min of yes. So it is an error because we have to import minimum. It's a different thing. I'll come to that later. Now see, the very important thing you have to note down on string is, say, when I have a string A equal to say A, and B equal to say B. When I say like this, you have to understand one important thing, because that is why I started my lecture on the basics of binary system and machine learning. Because this is very fundamental. You think that these are very fundamental, but why I'm explaining all these things to a commerce student means you should know how this is being compared. If when I say A greater than B, what is the answer? Alphabet A is greater than B. How it has been executing? No, false is the answer. How it is saying false? How it is comparing A is greater than B? Because internally it is calculating the numerals of A. What is the ASCII value for A? First find it. What is the ASCII value of A? Ordinals of A. It is what? 97. Next, if I say this is B, then what is the value of B? This is B, 98. So when I say A equal to, S equal to A, S1 equal to A, and S2 equal to A, and when I say this, S1 greater than S2, the answer is going to be false. Why? A value is 97 and B value is 98. 97 is not greater than 98. That is how it has been happening. So how can I know that? Find the ordinals of this one. Ordinals of S1 is what? 97. Likewise, ordinals of S2 is what? 98. So what is the answer? See? False. So if I remove this, you will get the answer correctly. Ordinals of these two things. 97 and 90. Last one is going to be printed out. So this one only, if you want to execute it, yes, you can execute. It is going to say 98 and 97. This is 97 and this is 98. So that is how the ASCII value of your character is getting out. So when you want to name a variable, we recommend to use uppercase. Please understand the point. Because the lowercase letters are ranging from 97 to 122. But uppercase letter, it is 65 to 90. So that is why we always recommend to name a variable in uppercase. Name the variable in uppercase. And when you type a DBMS, you're still in DBMS. So I don't know whether the faculty are saying it or not. Whenever you're typing a employee name and attribute name, it is to be in capital characters. Right? So that you just type a select asterisk from employee table or customer table, you can understand it. How the employees are displayed in the output in capital letters or small letters. You just see the output. Right? Internally, how it is stored. You just type selecting create table, table name. There is table name is employee, employee ID, employee name, employee salary, and insert some value to the employee table and select asterisk from employee. See the output. In the output, whether you're getting a small employee name, employee ID, I'm talking about attribute name, not values. You see that. So it is always recommended to use uppercase for variables because the conversion rate is very, very less because it takes only 65 to 90 range of bytes. So that is why we have to recommend this kind of things, right? This is the ordinance value. Next very important thing is there may be many confusion comes. There may be many confusion comes on strings. Let's say welcome to, I just convert my Wi-Fi. Yeah, it is now connected. Now see, welcome colon KPR students. Welcome, KPR students. If I say like this, what is your take? I want to give you a statement like this. Welcome, KPR students. You think that this is KPR student in single course and this course is ended over here. This course is ended over here. But what is happening actually here? This is not happening the way that you expected. It shows an error. Because here I'm closing it. The string started over here and closed over here. And this is not counted anywhere. So if you want to use this like this exactly, then you have to go for what backslash. If I go for backslash, then I'm getting the answer correctly. So like, wait a minute. Now see. I had to print it because I am not printing it. Print S1. So when I say print S1, what happened? This is going to be printed the way that you expected. So if you want to print like this, then what happened? Welcome, KPR. It's showing error like this, right? And likewise, if you are using this two backslash, this is a problem. Now say, I'm going to give like this. Let's say, this is Arjun. Now see the same problem. This is Arjun's son. So what happened? This is Arjun is ended over here because I quoted over here. And yes and son is not coming over here. So for that, what do you do? We have to go for what? Yeah, backslash. When I go for backslash like this, then what happened? It is going to give a proper syntax. So this is Arjun's son. So don't give a space. So this is Arjun's son. It is giving like this. So this backspace is very important. If you're not giving backspace, you're studying DBMS in this class, using where condition, if you are using any apostrophe, if you want to use any apostrophe, then you have to use backslash. This backslash escape sequence. Suppose if you want to use double quotes, as I mentioned already, for that you have to go for what? The double quotes. If I use this one, if you want to use this one, yes, you can go for this. Double quotes you can want. Yes, you can use it. This is what I mentioned in the previous example as well, right? So this is very, very important. The escape sequence are very, very important and you have to follow that. And likewise, if you want to connect two strings, both the strings are same or not, S1 is S2, yes, same. Both are allow and allow. So both are giving the same answer. And likewise, if you want to find the length of it or minimum of it, or if you want to find the string where it is positioned, for all of that, yes, you can say. Say, let's say I have a string, right? And say S1 equal to welcome to Python programming. This is a sentence. Now I want to print up to what? Up to first to four characters. S1 of 1 to say otherwise 0 to welcome 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or 6. Then if you want to extract only welcome, then it is going to say this one. So 7, including that 0. Welcome. 7 characters. Suppose if I want to start with 9, end with means 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, or 15. Up to 15 means Python only. If you want to extract, then you have to go forward this. 2 is started. So 9, not 9. This is 11. 11 to say 17. If you want to go, it takes only Python. So like this, you can go from which position to which position you want to slice it out. So slicing is a very important property. You think that these are all very trivial, very premature to learn in this class. Please don't take like this. String is very important. It has been widely used in NLP projects because see, we are all posting so much of content in web, in the means of WhatsApp, Facebook, LinkedIn, and many of the social media sites, right? And in comments also, if you're watching YouTube, you're giving comments. What is a comment? We are all giving text messages. Suppose if I want to find out, is there any vulgar word present in your content or not? For that, what I have to do? I have to find the extraction of your text. So I have to extract the meaning of it. Or if you want to extract something out of it, yes, you can find it. Suppose if you want to find only this word is present in your text or not, yes, I can find it. Keyword matching, meaning of your word matching. There are many researches going behind the scene. That is why strings are very, very important. You have to know all these operations. Suppose if you want to start from reverse, what is reverse? Minus one. What is minus one? G is a minus one. So minus one, two, what is that? Right? Minus one, two, what? Minus 10. It is going to print after space. So this is a space, right? So like this, you can start from minus one. So up to from minus five, minus four. We are starting from the minus four, M-I-N-G. So we are taking like that. So minus 10, only that characters, right? So you can go reverse also, or you can go front from the front portion also. So what are the things, yes, you want to go? Yes, you can go by that. Reverse of operation is also possible, right? So this is very important. This is very preliminary, but very important in programming. And this all the operation I already explained, multiplication and concatenation. And if you want to find in or not in, whether it is present in the text or not, and comparing, if you want to compare two strings, as I said already, it is going to find the ASCII value of your string and then check the values. It is doing both the same or not. So capital letter, say, I just say S1 equal to Sachin, and S2 equal to capital S, Sachin. Both are same. Let's see. S1 greater than or S1 equal to S2. False. S1 is not equal to S2. Why? Because here capital S is given. What is the ASCII value of capital S? It is what? 64. Some range is there. And this is S is what? Above 100. Lower case. So there may be a difference in the ASCII value. So that calculation has been happening over here. It's not same. So be careful on your comparing of strings, right? And there are many inbuilt functions available. So you can use is alpha, checking that is a value is alpha numeric string, or if you want to go for both alpha and number, or if you want to check whether the given value is only integer or not, or if you want to convert, or if you want to check whether the given string is lowercase, convert into uppercase, or if it's uppercase, convert to lowercase, all these things are possible, right? So these are the other operations we can have. And now I just go for a quick program to make you to understand how we are going to take it out. Right? Now I have given a string. Now I'm giving a string. S1 equal to welcome to Python program. Now I'm going to find out how many vowels are there in the given string. Vowels means what? A, E, I, O, U. How many vowels are there in the given string? So why I'm explaining this? Because you can write a complex program or you can write a simple program. Anything you can do, right? So see, I write a simple program. Now see, for vowel means what? V equal to, I'm giving A, E, I, O, U. So I'm saying for I in S1 means what? I'm taking each and every character from S1, W like that. If I in V count equal to count plus one. Right? Now see, print total number of vowels in S1 is what is the answer? Count. When I run it, what happened? It will show some error. Where is the error? Because count is not been initialized. So because count value is not known, count equal to zero. So I am assigning it. So total number of vowels is what? 8. It is printing like this because what I'm doing here, I in S1, I'm taking each and every character from S1, W. W is a vowel, V, no. A, E, I, O, U. In V, I have only A, E, I, O, U. So E, yes. L, no. C, no. O, yes. So it is taking like this. Suppose if you want to find out many A's are there, how many E's are there, something like that. If you want to find out, vowels is A-E-I-O-U. Suppose if you want to find out that kind of operation, then what you have to do is, I just show you the program for it, easy program. Now see, the same program, I just do it in one line also, or I can do it in simple lines without any for loop. Enter a sentence, welcome to Python programming. This is a letter I'm entering. When I entered it, it will tell me, sorry. When I enter it, it will tell me, welcome to Python programming. When I say it, it will tell me how many vowels. Again, there is a problem here. Let's see. Please type a string, vowels. I'll explain it, because the problem is on variable declaration. Now tell me, it will tell you how many A's are there, how many E's are there, how many I's are there, how many zeros are there, O's are there, U's are there. See what is happening here? I'm entering a string dynamically. I given a vowels A, E, I, O, U. For V in vowels, I'm taking each and every vowel, and that vowel, I compare the data. What I'm doing here is, even though when I'm typing everything in uppercase or lowercase, I convert into lowercase. If I give a uppercase letter or lowercase letter, I convert that into a lowercase letter and count that how many vowels are there in it. This is a count of V, that is a vowels. So I'm printing it. A is how many times? Welcome to programming. Only one A is there. So only one. E, two E's are there. I, only one I is there. So like that, I'm getting it. So this is how you can process your strings. In Python, no need to go for this much of things. Even in one line, you can do that. It's a different aspect, because for this alone, we can take multiple operations. Simple, the same thing, I can get it by only one line. Welcome to Python programming. Okay? Same code. No need to write this much of code. Only one line of code is enough to perform this task. That is why we recommend Python. That is why we ask you to go for Python. So this is a map function. The map functions are there, lambda functions are there, filter functions are there. Because I want to explain more by taking simple examples, I want to give you so much of conversions, how effectively we can write the program. So that is very important. That is where we have to improve your potential. If you want to augment your skills on any programming, it is not that you have to get the output. It is you to decide how effectively we are managing the locations, how managing the memory locations, and how you effectively process your content. That is the meaning of it. So these are all the things we explain, and conversion and all the things. So if you want to remove any white spaces, you can go for L trip. Left hand side white space will be removed. R trip, right hand side white space will be removed. If there is any unnecessary white spaces looming here and there, if you want to remove that, yes, you can do that by L strip or strip. Or totally, if you want to remove all the trailing white spaces, then you can go for strip. That's it. It will remove all the white spaces occupied in your string. And this is all I have. If you want to master on programming, the only way to learn a new programming language is by writing programs in it. This is given by Dennis Ritchie. If you want to master in programming, the only way to learn any new language, I have given Python now. If you want to master on Python, you have to practice it. So Python is a wonderful language. If you wonder whether something works or illegal, just try it. Then you can say whether it's legal or illegal, right? Don't be a spectator. Write programs, right? Like watching cricket, you can comment everything here and there. By looking at the TV, you can say that the catch can be caught by this means and this ways. But when you go into the field and play the real cricket, you will understand how tough it is. So that is, I'm saying, programming is not about a mere spectatorial point of view. It is to write programs. You have to practice. So practice only makes you to become a good programmer. And I know that I'm talking to a commerce student, but don't think that this is irrelevant. These are all very much relevant. You can do wonders in programming because Python is so simple. If you started working on it step by step, you just see many manuals available, step by step manuals. Go one by one. That is why I'm talking very little things about Python. I started with some basics. because it gives you some curiosity of learning some new things extra. That is why I'm just asking it. So if you have any questions, yes, you can ask. Now the floor is open for all. If you have any questions regarding what I talked or anything else you want to know, yes, you can. And you are most welcome to raise your hands.